So Joe, you are a special man. Why, you think?
It's not so much that I'm special. I guess I've done a few special things in my life. I realize this when I talk to other people, and it's especially because I followed a dream to pursue the discovery of nature.
Yeah. Can you show this in this restaurant? Because you show me something, the tree behind me. Can you put something from that?
Well, the thing is, there's a lot of human
Oh, yes,
tradition.
yeah.
There's a lot of human tradition that is enshrouded with mystery because the people who originally had the traditions lost them, and their children and grandchildren have forgotten them. So we lose things, and in the process, we've lost a great amount of human history. When you think about it, humans lived all over the planet. And as I always tell people, they survived in some of the most inhospitable and unusual environments, from the top of mountains. I just came from Peru, and people were up in 15,000 or 4,500 meter elevations living in huts. And then there's people who live in swamps and jungles and deserts all over the world. And all of those people, especially their forefathers and their ancestors, lived off the land. Before agriculture was common, a few thousand years back, people had to harvest things from nature. And over time, over the eons, they decided and learned what was edible and what was not. And much of that history, much of that secret world, is now lost to us modern people. So even though we may be richer or stronger or more economically comfortable, we have lost out on the mystery of the world. And
Okay.
that's what I'd like to share.
Okay. You can tell me two magic things.
Two
First,
magic
yeah,
things.
two. First from this one.
Yes.
Yes.
So
You told me somewhere I can make a product maybe for the brewery in Belgium.
yes. So this particular leaf, I was introduced to its edibility in a big way when I was in northern Vietnam, because people there collect fresh leaves and they serve them in bars and pubs for just enjoyment while mostly men are drinking beer. And so I call them beer food. So this leaf right here, which is a common ornamental houseplant, is actually known as Ding Long and can become a new culture for Europe.
Okay, this one is with poison. But
No,
you
this
no.
is not poisonous. This is edible too. This
Yeah.
is very closely related to this leaf. And in the South Pacific, they'll wrap fish in the bigger leaves and they'll cook them and eat the leaf and all, like a fish tamale.
Okay, but you told me something about how you recognize a plant who's poison.
Okay, well, that's a little bit different. I mean, in terms of advice, there are edible plants and there are poisonous ones, and I often associate my edibility with the type of family of plants it comes from. Like the cabbage family, almost all the species in the cabbage family are edible or at least not poisonous. If you take another family, such as the euphorbias, including things like poinsettias and cassava, there's both edible and poisonous members in that family, so you can't just use the knowledge of the family to sufficiently decide if a plant is edible or poisonous, and that takes a little bit more investigation. In certain instances, I use what is known as the Aboriginal method. The Aboriginal method is you take a leaf or a fruit, you rub it on maybe your arm in a sensitive area, and then you see if it gets a rash. If nothing happens, you may rub it on your lip. If nothing happens, your lip doesn't burn, maybe you'll stick your tongue on it. And if it doesn't burn your tongue, then maybe after a little bit more time, you'll just taste it a little bit. And if nothing bad happens over a period of hours or days, you may swallow it. And that's how the Aborigines actually tested to see whether something was edible or not. Not recommended in many cases because there are actually plants that will burn your tongue or burn your skin, but you get to know it after a few decades of working.
Thank you for this lesson.
Yeah.